So we're looking at, welcome, by the way. Good to see you. Good to see you. I hope this series is stimulating. It's been, you know, I found a document that I'd started writing in 2019 about the culture of the church. This has been something that's been brewing in me a long time, and because I think it's something really important that we understand. It's about aspiration as much as anything sometimes, because you know you can say, well, this is one of the values that we have, but it doesn't mean we're there yet with it. You know, there's still much to learn. And today we're talking about a subject that's goes right back to the origins of, well, even before New Frontiers, coastlands. It's been like a fundamental, because it is a fundamental for Terry Virgo, who was the founder of Coastlands, and which then became New Frontiers International, and then became New Frontiers because it was accepted that it was international. Didn't need to say that once you are. Because when you write New Frontiers International, it's an aspirational thing. You say, well, that's what we want to be. But then when you get there, it's like, well, that's a waste of a word, really. Anyway, the word is, it's not there, but it's grace, transforming grace. And if you were to cut Terry Virgo in half, like Brighton Rock, it would say grace inside him, I'm sure, because it is right up there, fundamental to who we are. Paul writes to the Romans, Romans 5, verses 1 and 2, therefore, since we have been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Through him, we have also obtained access by faith into this grace in which we stand. And we rejoice in hope of the glory of God. Ooh. Paul writes to the Romans, and he speaks of Jesus' work of redemption, and that by faith we are granted access into grace. This grace, we're told, is an abundance of grace, and the result of receiving this grace, which comes as a free gift, is the free gift of righteousness. So through grace, through this thing that we receive called grace, we receive righteousness, and in that we reign in life. So grace is kind of like the center of it. That's what we receive. And we'll talk about what grace is in a moment. So help us understand this word grace. Let's step through the passage. Paul says we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus, we're going to be celebrating communion today. Jesus did a work that means that now we have peace with God. And that's really important, because we beat ourselves up. God doesn't. We are at peace with him. Through the work of Jesus that he did on the cross and his resurrection. And the book of Romans has so much to say about this. It's a difficult book, Romans. But here in chapter 5, Jesus is compared to Adam, where it says death comes through Adam, but life comes through Jesus. It's like a fresh start. And that's why Jesus had to come as a man, because the first man made a mess. The second man took back what the first man had messed up. Romans 5:17 says, For if because of one man's trespass, death reigned through that one man, much more will those who receive the abundance of grace and the free gift of righteousness reign in life through the one man, Jesus Christ. Adam and Eve were presented with a lie by a serpent. You will surely not die, For God knows that when you eat of it, your eyes will be opened and you will be like God, knowing good and evil. Adam and Eve were presented with this opportunity to be more like God. The tragic thing was that they were already like God. And they tried to obtain through works what they already had by nature. And they were robbed by the serpent. The result actually was the opposite of what the serpent said. Because the world was then excluded from the tree of life. And the eyes were closed to truth. So Paul can write to the Corinthians saying, if our gospel is veiled, it's veiled to those who are perishing. So they were promised that they would know good and evil, but actually their eyes were closed to good. It becomes veiled, is what Paul is saying to the Corinthians. If our gospel is veiled, it's veiled to those who are perishing. In their case, the God of this world has blinded the minds of the unbelievers. Today, good and evil have been reduced to a social conscience where certain groups must not be offended. The truth has been made into this relative and personal thing. I pray that God would reverse that and open blind eyes in the light of his gospel. Jesus became the second Adam. And fulfills the law in two ways. First, he lives a life without sin. And so the law actually has no claim on his life because he is pure. The second is that he dies in our place, the spotless lamb paying the price for the sin of every man, woman, child who puts their trust in him. So the requirements of the law become fully satisfied. Paul argues about that the law itself isn't evil. The law itself is good. But the problem is that we cannot be made pure enough to fulfill the requirements of the law. But Jesus did that for us because he was. In the next part of the passage, Paul speaks to us of, versus in gaining a perfect life. Next part of the passage, Paul speaks of as gaining access through faith. Some of you who were around when Terry Virgo visited us, I can't remember how many years ago, he spoke of how he was visiting Washington with his wife. And he was preaching at a church, and the guy came up to him afterwards and said, would you like a tour of the White House? And he goes, I'd love to. And he goes, okay, what you need to do is arrive at the gate at this particular time. And so Terry and his wife arrive at the gate, and they're trying to explain to the guard that they'd met someone at church the previous day who had invited them to come in. And the guard was less than impressed. And the story suddenly felt really, really weak. All they could remember was the guy was called John, I think. And the guard was like, yeah, right. Yeah. Okay. But just at that moment, John appears. And he presents his credentials to the guard. And Terry and Wendy are in. And they go on this tour, and this tour far exceeds what the general public would normally see. They even step momentarily into the Oval Office. And so it is with us that we have this invitation that comes from Jesus, not into the White House, but this is an invitation to come before the Father. He presents his credentials at the gate. And it doesn't matter who we are, because he is the one with the credentials. Does that make sense? It doesn't matter whether, you know, anything about us that's irrelevant. It's his credentials that say, come in. And the scripture describes us, it says that we were dead in our sins, Ephesians 2:1. You know, that we, even our ability to, we weren't able to help ourselves. There was nothing that we could do, but he rescues us and he invites us. And the difference with John's credentials at the White House and Jesus' credentials is that not only do we gain access, but he also purifies us from all unrighteousness. All the debt of sin in our lives in that moment is gone. It's dissolved. It's washed away. And more than that, we are then issued with our own pass. Yeah? We don't need his credentials. Well, we do need his, but we are given our own pass into the presence of the Father at any time. That's the wonderful thing about grace, is that we just have that access. Sometimes the mess of our lives leaves consequences for the future. You know, a murderer isn't suddenly freed from the prison the moment they receive the forgiveness of God. But even there, God begins a work of redemption in that person's life. No matter what we've suffered in this life, God can do a healing work. We might never fully forget what has gone before, but the hurt and the shame doesn't need to stay. Jesus takes it away. In those verses we started with, Romans 5, 1-2, Paul writes that we have obtained access by grace, by faith, into this grace in which we stand, and we rejoice in hope of the glory of God. But what is grace? Oh, this guy called Lewis Smeads, I've no idea who he is, but I like what he said. He said, grace is too unpredictable, too lavish, too delicious for us to stay sober about it. It's too unpredictable, too lavish, too delicious for us to stay sober about it. Grace is something we celebrate at Jubilee. It's truly foundational to the way we behave and the decisions that we make. Like Mr. Smeads, we cannot stay sober about it, because it is truly amazing. The word grace is the Greek word charis. Charis was like it was a, it also can be translated favor. It's a word that was used as a greeting. So you would speak charis over somebody when you arrived or when you left or when you wrote a letter. And you find that Paul loves to combine both the Hebrew salutation and the Greek salutation. So he always writes, grace and peace to you. Charis, grace. Grace, which means to give favor to. And peace, shalom. That's another word in itself that we could spend a sermon on. But shalom. It's peace, but it's also health. It's also prosperity. It's peace with the world. It's right with the world. And Paul always combines these. You find in all his letters, peace and grace to you. He combines the Hebrew and the Greek salutation. Charis, grace, speaks of the redemption and the freedom and then the ongoing aid extended to us by God. It transforms us. If John Newton had remained a slave trader, there would have been something desperately incongruous about his most famous song. But what we see instead is a life transformed by realization of amazing grace. How sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. He knew what had happened to him. Within the Greco-Roman culture, grace was the work of a patron to benefit an individual or a group in what they were doing. A wealthy benefactor might extend grace, charis, to a sculptor to enable him to excel at his art, or to a young businessman to help him get a step up in life, or perhaps to an athlete to make a name for himself and, of course, his sponsor. That's what it meant to them. But Paul takes this word and says, well, that's what it is, but it's a lot more than that. The big difference with the grace of God that Paul speaks about is both in its quality. There's Chris. I'm not keeping up with this very well. Both in its quality, we were not only undeserving, but unable even to look for God's help. We were, as I noted earlier, dead in our sins, Ephesians 2:1. We were drifting, following the course of this world, Ephesians 2:2. And we were driven by the desires of our flesh, Ephesians 2:3. But God, being rich in mercy because of his great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses, he made us alive together with Christ. By grace we have been saved. Not only is it the quality of God's grace that's surprising, but the degree, the how much more of his grace. A benefactor, have I got that there? Oh, it's quality, sorry. A benefactor will carefully consider how much to give to maximize his or her benefit in public honor, in the grace, that contract, that sponsorship. God, however, is a God of abundance, not looking to maximize investment, but rather displaying the love of a father towards his children without counting the cost. If you then, who are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father who is in heaven give good things to those who ask him? Grace is what God does because he is gracious. Just as he is fundamentally good, as we talked about a couple of weeks ago, so also he's gracious to us. In Exodus 34, read how Moses takes two replacements. Remember, he smashed the stone tablets in his anger at them building this golden calf, and he has to carve out two more tablets to take up to God on the mountain. And when he's up there with these two tablets, God proclaims himself to Moses as the Lord, a God merciful and gracious, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love and faithfulness. Both mercy and grace are attributes that are primary to who God is. But we need to talk about the law, because God reveals himself to Moses as merciful and gracious, yet it was also the moment of the coming of the law. Law and grace abound together and yet represent different eras. And indeed two different covenants, and we're coming to the table of this latter covenant in a little while. The law was given to Israel. It was given so that the nation might know what was good and acceptable to God and what was opposed to him. It's like saying, well, this is what it looks like to be good. This is what it looks like that is unacceptable. The law served to make the practice of the nation distinct from the surrounding nations, because that was the point. You see, their worship was to be pure from any of the pagan practices of the Canaanites. They were to stand out. They were to look different. And also, it was about the care of the least and vulnerable in society. When you read through the law, There's so much in there about looking after the widow, the orphan. Their society was to be exemplary, a shining tribute to the nature of God himself. Jesus sums up the law as loving God and loving your neighbor. And that was always the case. It's not that Jesus reimagined the law. That was always the intention of what the law was for. The problem with the law is that it became a burden. And the very fact that a practice was outlawed became a temptation to indulge. Keep off the grass sign makes you want to run across it. Well, I don't know, maybe it doesn't you. But you go, why? Why should I keep off the grass? Bridget always says, you don't say, don't run ahead to a toddler, because all they hear is run ahead. In Romans 7, Paul describes this dilemma. Have I got that? I might have. I don't know why this is... Why is this not working? Paul writes, so I find it to be a law that when I want to do right, evil lies close at hand. For I delight in the law in my inner being, but I see in my members another law waging war against the law of my mind and making me captive to the law of sin that dwells in my members. Wretched man that I am. Paul makes Romans is difficult. But Paul puts himself in the place of Israel here and saying, we are delighting in the law, but we are unable to complete it. And if you read any commentary, that is what they'll say, because this is not about me now. Paul is not saying this is where I am now. He's building this argument about the problem of being under the law. And the answer comes a few verses later. The law of the Spirit of life has set you free in Christ Jesus from the law of sin and death. That's the answer. The law of the Spirit of life has set you free in Christ Jesus from the law of sin and death. The law of sin and death had a hold that could not be broken, and until now the law of the Spirit of life, grace, comes in to set you free. At the start of the same chapter, chapter 7 of Romans, Paul likens us to being married to the law of sin. We cannot escape this marriage. And this husband of ours, this called law, never does anything to help us do what's right, but instead constantly points out our failings. I'm sure you know no one like that. But this is an overbearing husband that's saying, you did this wrong, you did that wrong. Oh, you didn't do that very well, did you? Oh, you did that wrong. And that's all. He never does anything to help, just points out your failings. Adding to the most misery is the fact that actually the husband's always right. And to leave this marriage, I don't know, to leave this marriage would make us an adulteress. The only way to be free, the only way to be free from this miserable marriage contract is in death. And if the husband dies, then the woman is free to marry another. The only problem is the law's never going to die. This is the dilemma that Paul describes at the beginning of Romans 7. But the twist here is that rather than the law dying, Paul says that we die. We become mysteriously included in Christ's death. and resurrection. And then we're in him. So we die. When we die, that marriage contract is broken. It no longer holds. But then we're raised to life in Christ. In Galatians 2:20, Paul puts it like this. He says, I've been crucified with Christ, and it's no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself up for me. The marriage to law is now ended, and we're given a new life in Christ, that we might become betrothed. We are betrothed to him. We're released from the power of the law. That is like powerful. It's hard to overemphasize how key this is to life in Christ. All the I should have done this or I should have done that, the need to do penance, the need to feel bad about things until you feel the guilt lift, all that's gone. In fact, guilt itself becomes redundant. Let's talk about guilt for a moment. Guilt is a feeling that's there to prevent you doing something that's wrong or harmful. The problem with guilt is that when you do something wrong, then actually guilt itself becomes a problem because it now stands between you and God. And like Adam and Eve hiding from God, we cower away from him rather than doing what we should do, which is come to him, confess our sin, and he is faithful and just to forgive us our sin. That's what we should do, but the problem with guilt is that it stands there as this barrier, and we go, oh, I really messed up. And God's saying, where are you? I know he knows where we are, just as he knew where Adam and Eve is. But he was giving them opportunity to say, sorry, I messed up. In Christ you are no longer under condemnation. The law may still be alive, but has no right to condemn you. Jesus has made you righteous. If the law condemns you, you can point your old husband to your new fiancé and say, no, I'm made righteous in Jesus. I've got the pass. Just a thought, but trying to impress your old husband isn't going to impress your fiancé. Trying to do good by the law, we call it legalism. Some people call it religion. But there's a lot of it. In the church, a lot of it. Does that mean then we can do anything we like? Because of God's grace, we have no guilt. Does it? Well, actually, it does. But to do so would be a violation of our relationship with God. But it does. That's the point Paul gets to, where he makes that statement. He says, so does that mean we can do anything? Well, actually, we are forgiven. But it's not the right thing to do, because it breaks into that relationship then that we've created, that we've got, that God has created in us with him. Makes no sense. We've been released from this sheer thankless grind of a marriage to the law, and now we're engaged to Jesus, who by the Spirit helps us, unlike the law, who wouldn't lift a finger to help us. The Spirit helps us to do what's right, to do the Father's will. Not only that, but it's a life where we receive an abundance of grace and favor from God. Now to simply go and do what we please would be to go and flirt with all sorts of other consorts. It just doesn't make sense. It's just wrong. And I hope you understand. If today you feel like you're failing as a Christian, that your performance doesn't match up, then I want to break that off of you. It isn't about what you perform. You were called to walk in purity because you are free from sin. More importantly, you've been set free from the power of sin. You can live a life walking in the Spirit. If you've placed your life into God's hands and received forgiveness for sins and received His Spirit, then you are totally free. This is grace. To be freely, that's without cost, made completely free. No cost. But yes, there is an expectation that you want to embrace this new life, that you fall in love with Jesus. I don't know where I am up on here. There we were. Grace and truth. For from His fullness we've all received grace upon grace. For the law was given through Moses. Grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. Jesus bought us grace. He set us free from the curse of the law. He also brings us truth, and truth liberates us. Jesus said, if you abide in my word, you are truly my disciples. And if you know the truth will set you free. It's really another subject and probably something for another day, but grace and truth work together. We all have lies that we believe about ourselves, lies that hold us in judgment, that tell we were failures, tell us of our incompetence, or that we're scatterbrained or no good at relationships, etc., etc., etc. We all have had those. The power of these lies is they prevent us from fully entering into the grace of God. Truth, God's truth, sets us free, so that we're fully able to relax in God's grace. All the struggle, all the need for perfection goes. I don't like the word perfection. I like the word excellence. I don't like the word perfection. There was only one who was perfect, and that's God. But He calls us to excellence. But excellence is something that you do from a place of freedom, not from a need to perform. Returning to the verse we started with, therefore, since we've been justified by grace, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Through Him we have obtained access by faith into this grace in which we stand, and we rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. It starts with the new life started in a grace-filled act of faith. In the present we find peace, peace in our relationships with God and with others, and peace in our circumstances as we learn that all the aspects of life are held in the grace of God. He holds it all. And the result is that we're able to stand. A picture of composure and unhurriedness, a place of strength and confidence. It then ends by looking into the future. As we look at the future, we see the glory of God on our lives and on the church. And the only possible response is to give praise and glory back to the God in which we hope. I want to tell you about a guy called Will Wood. I've talked about him before, so you might remember him. But when I was a teenager, I went to a church, and there was a guy called Will Wood. Will Wood, Wood Saw Wood. Will Wood used to be a woodwork teacher, but he was now old. His family would have nothing to do with him because he was so miserable. And he would come to church religiously every Sunday. Goodness knows why. And he would sit there sour-faced and moan about everything and then go again. And in the end, Will was unable to look after himself, and he ended up in what we had in those days, what are they called? geriatric wards. He ended up in a geriatric ward. And he was a right pain in the backside in this geriatric ward. And the sister really struggled with him because he just was so miserable. But he'd come to church every Sunday. And my pastor preached grace the whole time. In whatever he was preaching, he was full of grace. And I think was one of the best preachers I've ever heard on grace. But one Sunday we had this upstart of a visiting preacher called Terry Virgo. And he preached grace, not very well. But Will Wood got it for the first time ever. And he's like, in his 80s, he's like, why did it have to wait till now? He got grace. Will Wood was transformed. All the grumpiness went, he was just like this radiant guy. And he was, at that point, was changing from one ward to another ward. And the sister had warned this other sister, who was in charge of the other ward, about Will. Like, just take care, because he's... And this other sister didn't understand it. It's like, he's the nicest guy. He's like this proper gentleman. And Willwood, because he was still very good with his hands, he couldn't do carving or anything like that anymore, not in a geriatric ward. But he had some pens. And in those days, we used to have a lot of personal prophecies. I don't know why we don't do that these days. But if somebody was, like when I went off to university, I was brought out the front, and people would bring a prophetic word for you. And there was a couple of ladies who could do shorthand and would write it all down. And Willwood could read shorthand, and they'd give it to him. And if you were gone, then it was in the post. But actually, I was still there the following week, and he came up to me, and he'd do this for everyone. This card, beautifully written in, beautiful handwriting, all illustrated, and I've still got it. He'd give you this card and say, this was your word from last week, and with this huge smile on his face, like this, that was his ministry. He found a ministry. He wanted to be useful. He wanted to be part of what was going on because he got grace. Grace had changed his life. All the weight had gone. All the struggle. All the bad stuff. Guilt, whatever it was, gone. He was as light as a feather. Just sort of think of Scrooge, isn't it? He says, I feel as light as a feather. So that was Will Wood. Many of you know Angela Kim, the amazing lady who worked so tirelessly during apartheid in Cape Town to get the townships that the people deserved, the rights for the black people. And I think it was the last time she was with us, which was a few years ago now, because of this wretched COVID. But she told us, she shared this picture with us. It was about how every day at that time she was in London, and every day she would walk past the construction site of the Shard. And for many months there was just these hoardings. But you could peer through the occasional hole to see what was going on. And actually all you could see was like this bottomless pit. Like, down, like a long way down. But then, suddenly the Shard goes up, and they were putting the glass on as they were building it. So you had all these reflective surfaces on it, absolutely beautiful thing, just rose out of the ground really fast, like months and months and months, just a hole in the ground. And then very quickly it was going up. Our lives together, exuding the grace of God to others, shining in the light, beautiful but still unfinished. That's the picture she gave us. Like, all that stuff had to be dug out. All the unstable stuff had to go. That's what Jesus did. That was the big work. And now, something extraordinary coming up, something worth celebrating that will rise above everything else around it. Yeah, it started with the hole in the ground. But that's the work of the grace of work. That's the work of grace and truth. That's what it does. Completely fresh start. Our lives together, finding, making unity, sharing love and fellowship, pressing into all that God has for us, both individually and corporately, exploring how lavish His grace is, as Paul writes to the Ephesians. His lavish grace for us now and in the years and days to come. And throughout eternity, how immeasurable are His riches of His grace towards us in Jesus. When we receive grace, surely we must extend that to others. I couldn't find a verse that actually says, because God is full of grace, then you should be. I don't think it needs to be written. Because God has lavished His grace upon us. You know what? Grace only becomes grace when it costs something. So it's when we find somebody annoying or bothersome or inconvenient that grace comes into action. Because grace isn't grace when it's easy. That's not grace. Grace is when it's hard. The neighbour that calls you when you're in the middle of something. The small child that stomps around in the church service. The colleague that always takes you for granted. We don't like our world being upset by another. But our response should be grace. Grace and more grace. Grace that flows from the Father. That lavish grace. I'm going to pray. I'll keep going otherwise. Father God, I thank You for Your love and for the lavish grace that rescued me when I didn't even know I needed rescuing. Thank You for the peace that I now receive right now in Christ. To be at peace with You, at peace with myself, at peace with those that I interact with. Thank You, Father, that in Your grace I can stand in confidence that whatever comes my way, I cannot be snatched from Your loving care. Jesus, thank You so much for the gift of righteousness. Thank You for loving me before even I was born, and coming to die, taking my sin, taking my failure, taking my shame, and giving me new life. Holy Spirit, thank You for opening my eyes and ears to see in the light of the gospel. Help me to learn to move as You blow here and there. May my spiritual senses become ever more attuned to what You are doing and walk blamelessly for the sake and for the glory of God. Amen.